Hello, welcome to the Awakening Report. I'm your host, Doug Hamp. We have a special guest today, Nehemia Gordon. He is going to share with us his perspective on the name of God. And I'm very excited to have him. He is a fellow graduate of the Hebrew University, and I think he's probably quite a bit smarter than me. He holds a master's degree in biblical studies and a bachelor's degree in archaeology from the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. That's also where I went. And so that was pretty cool to discover that. He's worked as a translator on the Dead Sea Scrolls and as a researcher deciphering ancient Hebrew manuscripts. He's a prominent figure in the Karaite Jewish community, and Gordon has written two popular books on the Hebrew origins of Christianity and is active in interfaith dialogue, and he speaks at synagogues and churches around the world and leads groups of pilgrims and visitors on tours of biblical sites. So welcome with me, Nehemia Gordon.
Shalom, it's great to be there.
Hey, yeah, it's really awesome. So it's good to have a fellow alumnus from the Hebrew University. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
So now you went there, you studied in the Hebrew faculty. I studied at the overseas.
Well, I just found out we took the same course with Hanan Eschel, who is one of the most brilliant scholars I've ever encountered in my life. Historical Geography of the Land of Israel or something like that it was called. It was actually one of the most interesting classes I ever took.
Yeah, that was one of the most
challenging. What I loved about Hanan Eschel is he was always, let's look at the evidence and then we'll make a decision based on the evidence. And a lot of what I encountered in academia was, okay, we've got this thesis we want to prove. How do we prove it? Which is the exact opposite of what you're supposed to do. So Hanan Eschel was one of those few people who really was, let's look at the evidence, and then we'll figure out what it is. Like, you know, and then it's easy, you know. And it's not easy because you've got to, you know.
Yeah, you still got to decipher
the evidence and decipher what's important, what's not important. But so I studied in the Hebrew faculty. I actually did a double major of biblical studies and archaeology. And then my master's is just in biblical studies.
Neat. That's awesome.
Yeah.
And I appreciate that. I mean, you know, evidence-based research is what we should be doing. I mean, that's what we demand from, you know, the harder sciences, right? And, you know, biblical studies, et cetera, are sometimes considered soft sciences, right?
Well, I mean, think about this. If you went to the doctor and the doctor said, well, we know we're supposed to give you this medicine. We don't have proof of it, but we're going to take this study, and actually they do that in science.
They do that, yeah.
Medicine. They'll say, we're going to ignore all the studies that fail. I think they just passed a law in the U.S. or maybe in England that in order for a study to be valid, it has to be registered, and then they have to share the results even if they don't like them. But they used to be able to ignore the results, like even a few years ago. And that's what I find happening a lot of historical studies and biblical studies as well, is people will just ignore the stuff that doesn't fit what they want to argue. Mm-hmm. And they'll, you know, we call it, or they call it in politics. I learned this in U.S. history in like eighth grade. It's called gerrymandering, right? Mm-hmm. You want to win a district in an election. So you have a district that's some ridiculous shape to, like, you know, so you get the votes. And so people will gerrymander the evidence of, you know, whatever they want, you know, and I've seen that with all kinds of things, but definitely in biblical studies that happens as well. From people of faith. It happens, I would say, even more so with academic scholars who are coming. You know, one of the problems with and I didn't realize this. It took me years to fully understand this. But one of the real big problems with publishing something in a peer-reviewed journal is, well, every time you've got to come up with something new that no one's ever said before. Okay, well, if we're dealing with truth, hopefully you're not coming up with something new that no one's ever said before. You might be, but, you know, more often than not, you should be coming up with what people has just been obvious for thousands of years and shouldn't be different, right? You know, and I'm a Karaite Jew, which is a strictly Old Testament Jew. I was raised as an Orthodox Jew. My father was a rabbi. Taught me sitting on his knees that Moses received two separate and distinct revelations. One is the written Torah and the other is the oral Torah. And growing up, I just couldn't accept this oral Torah. I said, I just want to follow the word of God, which is the written scriptures, what Jews call the Tanakh, Christians call the Old Testament. But the truth is, if you look at what the Tanakh says versus what the rabbis say, there's still like an 80-90% overlap, right? And it's on those 10-20% that where all of the effort and energy is sometimes invested. Sometimes it's a good thing, sometimes it's a bad thing. Sometimes it's something very, very small where we actually agree on the interpretation, but we don't necessarily agree on how to implement it today in the 21st century. That's where things get, you know, complicated. But the point is that, you know, most of what Jews have historically said is pretty accurate, you know. I mean, the way they've interpreted the Bible, and like I said, it's probably that 10-20% where, you know, we have some issues, and I go and say, what does the Bible say? You know, that's my approach.
And what do you think as far as the oral law? I mean, how far back? Obviously, we have a very long tradition, but how far back does that actually go?
Do you really want to go down that rabbit hole?
Well, so, maybe just a little bit.
I mean, what the evidence says is that, did you ever study with Yisrael Yevin Yisrael Levine in the archaeology department at Hebrew University?
I didn't study with him.
So he gave a great class about the history of the synagogues. And one of the things he argued is that the synagogues are a continuation of ancient sanctuaries, which became basically illegitimate because of what's called the Josianic Reform. Long story short, in the Tanakh, you have this thing called high places. And the high places were destroyed by Josiah. And when they were destroyed, we find out this very surprising piece of information in the Book of Chronicles, that the priests of the high places don't disappear. And they don't accept Jerusalem as the one true place of worship, which is commanded by Leviticus 17 and Deuteronomy 12. Instead, they say, we're going to continue in our cities to perform these some of the ceremonies of the high places. I'm paraphrasing, obviously, right? And so it's very possible that some of the traditions in the oral law go back to these high places. And when the rabbis say we have these traditions that go back to very early times in Jewish history and the history of Israel, they might not be wrong in some instances. And that sounds kind of crazy, but I could give you examples of things that continue, traditions that are maintained, and there are things that I'll give you just a really simple example. In the Mishnah, it says that tying a red string around your arm is forbidden magic. Now, if you go to Jerusalem today and you go to the Western Wall, there'll usually be old ladies who will have this red string, and they'll, you know, give it to you, and it's free, except they want money. And then you'll tie the red string around your hand, and it'll bring you good luck. Now, wait a minute. It says in the Mishnah, written in the year around the year 200, that this is forbidden magic. And today, if you ask any religious Jew, he'll tell you, oh no, it's a very holy string. I mean, it's some kind of thing. It's wrapped seven times. The spool of string is wrapped seven times around the tomb of Rachel's, all kinds of, you know, the blessings are made over it. And there's even a story where Ashton Kutcher, the famous actor, had one of those red strings because he's into Kabbalah. He had one of those red strings on his arm, and they spent hundreds of thousands of dollars brushing it out of the Hollywood movie that he was in, because he refused to take it off because it brought him, you know, a good blessing. So there you have an example of a tradition that's 2,000 years old. 2,000 years ago, the Jewish establishment understood this is superstition and therefore forbidden by Deuteronomy 18. They called it Dalkei HaEmori, the ways of the Amorites, or magic, superstition. Today, it's accepted that, look, we have an ancient tradition of doing this. And I come along and say, this is forbidden, not only by the written Torah, by the oral Torah, it's forbidden. And people laugh at me. They say, you're telling us something from some book, even if it's our book. They literally laugh me in the face when I tell them this is forbidden. I show them in the book. They don't care. My rabbi did this. His rabbi did this. This has been done for centuries. I don't doubt it's done for centuries. So my point is that here we have an example of something which is proclaimed to be Jewish tradition and actually goes back to something that, even according to the oral law, is a forbidden superstition. And I suspect many of the traditions in the oral law go back to actually to the high places. Many of them may be very, very old. And what I mean by that is, you look at the Book of Judges, we have this great story about this priest at a high place who has a silver statue, and he's apparently the grandson of Moses. And I say apparently, are you familiar with the Hanging Nun? We're supposed to talk about the name, but this is way off topic. This is a great, great topic.
Go for it.
So there's this one passage in Judges, and I could look it up here if I just real quick, where it mentions that he's Yonatan, the son of Menashe. But if you look or something like that, it's in Judges. Here, I'm pulling up the verse on my little computer program here. Judges 18:30. Then the children of Dan set up for themselves the carved image, and Jonathan, the son of Gershom, the son of Menashe, and his sons were priests to the tribe of Dan until the day of the captivity of the land. And if you look in the manuscript, it says Menashe, but the Nun is hanging halfway as if it was into the word. And if you take out the Nun, it doesn't say Menashe, it says Moshe. So this priest is the grandson of Moses, and he's involved in a high place. And not only is he involved in a high place, the very fact that he's descended from Moses is his claim to legitimacy. Right? Oh, he's saying, look, you're reading in the book of my grandfather telling me it's forbidden to have a statue of the God of Israel, a silver statue. My grandfather wrote that book. Who do you think you are? I mean, that's the conversation that went on back then. So it's very possible that some things in the oral law go back to the high places.
Now, when you say the oral law, you're suggesting that the things in the oral law were written against some of those things. Is that what you're suggesting?
Oh, no, that some of the actual traditions in the oral law go back to the high places. There might be things against the high place. And it's interesting because if you look in the Talmud, and by the way, when we say oral law today, what we really mean, because it's not oral anymore, right? So what we mean is the Talmud, the Mishnah, and maybe a few other things that we can throw in there, but that's not all the Midrashim even, sure. But the earlier ones. So that's generally what we talk about when we say the oral law today. If you ask Orthodox Jews, they'll throw the Zohar in there as well, but that's kind of an anachronism. I think there may be actually things in this oral law that go back to the high places. And according to the rabbis, the high places before the time of Solomon were permissible. Where does it say that in Leviticus 17 and Deuteronomy 12? Leviticus 17 talks about bringing all sacrifices to the entrance of the tent of meeting. And Deuteronomy 12 talks about bringing your sacrifices only to the place where God chooses to put his name. And there was only ever one place like that. It was first the tabernacle, wherever that happened to be. And then it was the temple in Jerusalem. So, like I said, this is a major digression, right? We want to get to the name. Sure. But I think it's important. So one of my issues when it comes to the name is that it's the rabbis who forbid us to speak the name. I grew up that we don't speak God's name. You know, in your community, I'm assuming I know what your community is, and I guess I don't really. In your presumed community,
it's messianic. I mean, that's, you know.
Okay, so you're messianic. Okay, I was assuming that. Yeah. So in your community, there's 100 different theories of how to pronounce the name, and people will pronounce it in those different ways. In the Jewish community, people don't pronounce the name. It's forbidden. Mm-hmm. And I grew up with this idea that this was absolutely completely forbidden. And then later I find out that, well, yeah, it's forbidden now, but when the Messiah comes, it'll be permissible again. In fact, everybody will say the name when the Messiah comes. Hmm. That's actually right there in the Talmud. That wasn't something that was taught in the synagogue or you know, and when I studied Talmud as a kid, it was very specific passages. I mean, there were vast passages, right? Yep. But if the Talmud is, and I'm just guessing off the top of my head, if it's 1,000 pages, then the average Orthodox Jew who has a very advanced education won't read more than 200 of those pages, and the other 800 pages, I don't know if that's the exact number. I'm pulling a number out of the air. It is probably something in that neighborhood. So they'll read 200. I mean, even 50 pages would be considered quite a good. So who knows what's in those other 950 pages, right? And it turns out this is one of the statements in those pages that, I mean, today it's actually quite easy to search these things with computers and the internet. You know, I have a database that cost me like $1,000 where I can search almost not all of rabbinical literature, but a large percentage of it in Hebrew, of course. There was a time
when 2,711 pages in the Babylonian Talmud.
There you go. Okay.
Included in the Gemara. So, yeah.
Okay. Well, the Gemara includes the Mishnah. It's inclusive of it. Right. So of the 2,700, isn't Google amazing? So of the 2,700 pages, I would guess that a very educated Orthodox Jew might read 200 of those pages, but that would be like a yeshiva education. That's an advanced education to read. So think about that. That's I'm bad at math, but that's less than 10%, right? Mm-hmm. So what's in the other 2,500 pages? And it turns out one of the things that's in there is that the prohibition to speak God's name is not from the Torah. The prohibition to speak God's name is from tradition, and it's a relatively late tradition. There's a rabbi named Hanina ben Taradion who was burned at the stake by the Romans during the Hadrianic persecutions, meaning roughly sometime around 135, 138, sometime in that neighborhood. We don't know the exact year. But he was burned at the stake by the Romans for speaking the name of God the way it's written, or it says according to its letters, meaning he actually spoke the name YHWH. Of course, the problem is once the tradition really took hold sometime after that. And so, by the way, what we're saying is 100 years after Yeshua of Nazareth, there was a rabbi burned at the stake for speaking the name. Wow. And that's corroborated by other sources, which is incredible.
Why would the Romans burn this guy at the stake? I mean, why?
Oh, because they didn't want the Jews to circumcise their children. They didn't want the Jews to observe the Sabbath. And they certainly didn't want the Jews calling upon the name of their God. If we can get everybody to say God, then we can all pull a bait and switch and say it's the same God, right?
Clever.
If we get everybody to say Theos or Domina.
Domini or something.
Deus in Latin, mm-hmm. But in the Eastern Roman Empire in Israel, it would have been Theos, which is the Greek word. If we get everybody to say the same word, and it's a generic word, mm-hmm. right? If I say Zeus, well, I can't go – if I'm a Greek, God forbid, and I go to India and I say, hey, I worship the same God as you and his name is Zeus, they'll be like, wait a minute. No, our God's not called Zeus. But if I go to the people in India and I say, hey, we worship the same God and his name is God, okay, we happen to call him something and you call him something else. And that was a very popular idea in the Eastern Roman Empire at the time. Mm-hmm. And the Jews were considered sort of backward that they say, no, we're the only ones who worship the true God. And he has a name, YHWH. So they made this rule, this ruling that forbidding Jews to speak the name the way it was written. Anyway, so it turns out this is actually a prohibition originally by the Romans. And then the rabbis have some internal reasons to forbid it as well, but these things line up around the year 150 or 200. By 250, it's the name is well entrenched. Don't speak the name. Yeah,
wow.
I wouldn't say it's a goner, but it's pretty wide. It would be very unusual, I think. And there are people. I mean, I found documents where there's a rabbi in the 15th century who got in trouble because he was speaking the name according to its letters. The same thing the rabbi in the Hadrianic persecutions did. That he was burned at the stake by the Romans. So I found a document which has never been published and it's never been translated into English. And it talks about, and I'm going to actually release this in a study soon, God willing. But it describes this he's called a sage, and he's rebuked by a rabbi because he speaks the name according to its letters. Well, wait a minute. That means he knew how to speak the name.
Wow.
Right. And the assumption is the Jews didn't know the name. And so if you go and you look at scholarship, if we go to our alma mater, the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, and ask scholars, well, how was his name pronounced? First, they'll say, well, we're not really sure. But the best evidence we have comes from four major types of sources. We've got Christians writing in Greek. We have pagan sources. And by pagan, I actually mean pagan, meaning like people who worship Horus and that kind of thing. And usually they wrote what are magical texts. And then you have, and actually like amulets and like, you know, good luck charms and things like that. And one of the names they use in those good luck charms is the name of the God of Israel. But they're writing in Greek. Then you have Gnostic sources writing in Coptic, which is translated from Greek, which is translated from Hebrew, or maybe from Aramaic and then from Hebrew. And then you have Akkadian sources, which are really the weakest of the sources because we don't really know how Akkadian was pronounced. We can reconstruct Akkadian, but we don't have a tradition of how it's pronounced. So they'll look at any source in the world, but they won't look at the Jewish sources because the assumption is the Jews didn't know the name.
Hmm.
Right? But if you ask the Jews, they certainly think they know the name. They won't speak it.
Uh-huh.
I'm not one of these people who say if you don't speak the name the exact way that I speak it, which is Yehovah, then you are going to be cast down into the pit of hell. I think that's utter nonsense. In fact, we have a passage in Psalm 44. I brought this passage in my book, Shattering the Conspiracy of Silence. I want people to go read that psalm tonight. Psalm 44 talks about God looking at our hearts, and I'm paraphrasing, right? Sure. Looking at our hearts. I think it says kidneys, if I'm not mistaken. and examining our what's really in our heart, even if we call upon the name of the wrong God, of a foreign God, he'll accept that from us if our heart is in the right place. And it's describing their situation where Israel's in exile and turning to God, and we don't even remember his. It's not that we don't know his name. We're calling on the wrong name. We're calling on, you know, if this is the context of Babylon, we're calling on Marduk or, you know, whoever, right?
Yep. It's verse 20. It says, if we had forgotten the name of our God or stretched out our hands to a foreign God, would not God search us out, for he knows the secrets of our heart?
Right. And again, I think in Hebrew it says kidneys, but whatever. Okay. What verse is that? I just want to see because that's kind of funny.
That's 20 and 21.
Okay.
It says, no, it's actually Lev. So it's the word Lev. So,
oh, it is? Yeah. Okay. All right. Because a lot of times it'll talk about searching out your mind and it's, it's Ta'alumot Lev. You know, it's Klayot, which is, you know, one of these, set, you know, they didn't think of the brain like we do. Anyway, yeah, so it's Lev. Absolutely. Okay. So and it's the hidden things of the heart is what it says. Ta'alumot Lev. It's beautiful. Anyway, so the point is if we call him the wrong name, he'll have mercy on us. So if we call him the right name and we mispronounce it, I don't think he's going to reject us and cast us down to the pit of hell. I think he will accept our prayers, I believe. I think that's consistent with that verse and pretty much everything else I read in the Tanakh. And look, my name is Nehemia. There's people who call me Nehemia and Nehemiah. And I say, oh, that's fine. Just don't call me Baldy. You know, it's very kind of sensitive.
You know? There you go.
And calling upon the name of the creator of the universe. You know, the name of God appears in the Hebrew Bible 6,827 times. Mm-hmm. So it appears actually more than all of the titles combined. We have these wonderful, beautiful titles, Elohim, which is God. And I have no problem with saying God, which is the English translation of Elohim. Sometimes I'll encounter the word police, and the word police will say to me, oh, no, you can't say God. God is the name of a Norse deity. And I'm like, well, I speak English. You actually do understand me, okay. But I can speak the entire conversation in Hebrew. And then I'll say Elohim, but if I'm speaking English, I'm going to say God. And Lord, which is a translation of Adonai. Technically, Adonai is my great Lord. So we have these beautiful titles that appear somewhere in the neighborhood of 2,500 times. It's complicated because how many of those Elohims refer to foreign gods? And I don't think anybody's ever counted. But my guess is somewhere around 2,500 times. That God is called by these various titles. Maybe it's 3,000, right? But the name itself is in the Aleppo Codex 6,827 times, the Leningrad Codex 6,828 times. That's more than all the titles combined, actually twice as many times as all. So this is an important name. Now, you're coming from a New Testament perspective, and from a New Testament perspective, which, you know, I can only speak as a researcher about the New Testament. I'm not a Christian. I'm not a Messianic Jew. But from the New Testament perspective, I think you have some really strong evidence that it's an important name. Mm-hmm. You know, you have this talking about Yeshua saying, I came in the name of my Father. I'm, again, paraphrasing. And there's this incredible passage I was actually discussing recently with someone, John 10. And out to me, and you know, this is one of these passages that you read and you don't really pay that much attention to, or at least what the ramifications are for this particular topic, right?
Right, of course.
You know, you everyone will dissect this looking at a different issue, mm-hmm. And I'm looking for the passage where he talks about teaching his disciples his Father's name. Help me out here.
Right,
that's in John 10.
It's 29, or let's see here, 10.
My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my... No, that's not it. But it's somewhere around there. And let's see.
I'm looking here. Wait. It's in there somewhere. Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
no, it's I mean, pretty big in there somewhere.
And your point is that this is... Where's important stuff. I mean, yeah. So, go ahead. Yeah.
Well, it's very important. And so what people will do is they'll, you know, they'll perpetrate this anachronism. Anachronism is when you project something back in time from the wrong time period. And one of my favorite examples is in the movie History of the World Part One, which kind of dates me, right?
Right.
There's this scene where I think it's Richard Pryor and he's walking in the Roman Forum with a boombox, which the young people know what that is.
Right.
It's like a... Yeah. It's like an iPod or a cell phone,
yeah.
But it's a giant thing that people would hold up to their ear.
Right.
So in ancient Rome, they didn't have boom boxes. That makes it an anachronism. And people who project this prohibition to speak God's holy name onto Yeshua of Nazareth, I believe that's an anachronism. And that's a whole sidetrack that I don't know if we want to get down.
Yeah, I would like to actually. But it's John 10:25. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me.
No, that's not the one.
That's not. Oh, well, no. Two strikes and I'm almost out here.
Yeah, I think. Well, it's my fault. I should have the verse off the top of my head before I brought it up. But
sure.
Yeah. Anyway, no, I was reading this with a Messianic guy, and he was like, you know, so this proves. I'm like, wow, I hadn't really thought of that. I mean, you know, I didn't. Yeah. Anyway, now I'm looking in my computer program at all the places in both the Old and New Testament where it says the word name. I'm gonna find it. because that I brought
we'll
it
find
up.
It before the end of the show, so that's the
right
good
right
news.
Right
yeah
yeah interesting. I don't know where this is. Okay. Anyway, maybe it's not John 10. I could be in the wrong.
Since I've come in my Father's name, if you don't receive me, if another comes in his own name, that's John 5. Yeah. Well, anyway, I mean, so okay. And then John 12, Father, glorify your name. Maybe that's it.
Yeah. So,
yeah.
Anyway, so, yeah. So it's in there somewhere, I'm pretty sure. So, yeah. But we definitely have this idea of him coming in his Father's name. And how do you do that if the name isn't spoken? Now here's where people get kind of strange in your community, because you'll have people who say, well, the name of Jesus isn't Jesus, it's Yahushua.
Uh-huh.
And why is it Yahushua? Because the Father's name is Yahuwah, and we have to have that Yahuwah inside the name Yahushua, which maybe you can explain that to me, because
I don't know where you got that, you know, but
It really sounds like a series of non sequiturs to me. And here's what they're missing. So there are, and you know this very well. So there are many names in Hebrew which are compound names. We like to call them in scholarship theophoric names. That's a fancy way of saying it's the name of a person who has the name of his God in his name. So what's an example of that? I'll give you an example which has nothing to do with the God of Israel, which shouldn't be controversial. So the second king of Israel, most people think it's David, but actually the second king of Israel is the son of Saul, whose name is Ishbosheth, which means man of shame. But his friends didn't call him Ishbosheth. That would have been a nasty thing to call him, and it's intended to be such in the book of Samuel. His friends called him, we know from Chronicles, Eshbaal, which means man of Baal. Okay, so that's a theophoric Nesh or Ish, which is man, and Baal, which is the name of the pagan deity. Actually, not the name of the pagan deity. It was the title of the pagan deity. The name of the pagan deity was Hadad, but the Canaanites believed that was an ineffable name. They weren't allowed to speak the name of God. It was too holy to speak, so they called him Lord. It's an interesting, you know, we talked before about traditions coming from the high places. Who knows, right? Mm-hmm. So they didn't call Hadad by his name. They called him Baal, and there's a king of Israel called Man of Baal. Okay, so theophoric names are, for example, Joseph is Yehovah Yosef. Yehovah will add, supply. And it's a blessing. So the man walks around his whole life named Yosef, and he's carrying the name of the creator of the universe, Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, in his own name, in the name Yosef.
Or Yehoshaphat, right? That's another good one.
Okay. Means Yehovah judges. Yehoyada, Yehovah knows. These are all kings, or the last couple are. Yehoram is Yehovah is on high, or Yehovah is lifted up. We've got some, I don't remember the exact number, but there's a bunch of names like this. There's also names that have the theophoric element, meaning the name of the God at the end. So for example, we have Yeshayahu is Yehovah saves, which is the same name as Yehoshua. The only difference is you take the Yeho and the Yoshia, and that's Yehoshua. And if you switch them around, you get Yeshayahu.
Yeah.
Now, wait a minute. Why is it Yeshayahu? Why isn't it, if some of the people that we're encountering on the internet, let's put it that way, if they made up the rules of Hebrew grammar, so the name Joshua is Yahushua, and the name Isaiah should be Yahushua. It should be Shua Yahu, right? But that's not how Hebrew works. The name Isaiah is Yeshayahu, not Shua Yahu. It's just not a word. And the name Joshua isn't Yahushua, it's Yehoshua. Why is that? There's all kinds of rules, and some of them are quite frankly arbitrary, but there is a certain amount of consistency in some of these rules.
Right.
So if you look at those rules, all of the names that begin with Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh begin with Yeho, and there are some exceptions like Judah, which I'll get to in a minute. And all the names that end in Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh are Yahu at the end. So what's an exception? An exception is, and by the way, the Yeho truncates to Yo. And so Joseph is Yosef, but the full form of Joseph actually appears in the Tanakh at least once as Yehosef, which is Yehovah Yosef or Yosef. Yehovah will add. So there's an exception, Judah, and why is Judah an exception? Because it's Yehovah Odeh, which means Yehovah, I will, and same sound twice, meaning it what you basically, the name should have been Yehodeh or Yehoodeh, right? So that's Hebrew doesn't like that. Many languages, including Hebrew, have this process called dissimilation. It's the opposite of assimilation. Mm-hmm. Dissimilation is where you have two similar sounds and it creates a difference to avoid having two similar. So Yehoodeh becomes Yehuda. Yeshua is actually an example of that. Yeshua, the full form of the name Yeshua is Yehoshua, which is simply Joshua. Mm-hmm. In Second Temple times, the letter He was not pronounced, or it was pronounced in a much softer way by many Jews. So Yehoshua became Yoshua. And Hebrew doesn't like this O-U-S cluster. Mm-hmm. So Yoshua, by dissimilation, becomes Yeshua. There's another name like that, by the way, Yehu, who is king of Israel, who is, you know, the full form of his name, which never appears, is Yehohu, which means he is Yehovah. And Yehohu becomes Yohu, which Hebrew doesn't like that O-U cluster, so becomes Yehu and Yeshua. Those are actually the same exact examples of dissimilation. Sorry, guys, that's very technical, that concept.
And just to help people understand, you know, just some kind of basic English ideas. You know, we have things to help us understand words a little bit better. You know, an apple, you don't say a apple, right? Because you just, the just doesn't work in English, right? So we say an apple.
Right.
That's kind of a crude example.
That's assimilation. It might actually be. It's an interesting question. A apple. That actually could be. That might be what that is. But let's be honest. What do Americans really say? If we're speaking in everyday speech, we might say an apple.
Right.
Right.
Or we'll say what's Chicago, up. That's what I or say. What's up, you know?
What's up? Right. We'll say what's up. Right. And then some of those forms have already entered the dictionary, like don't from do not, and can't from cannot. But then other ones haven't entered the dictionary, so we call that slang. Well, the idea of a dictionary is relatively modern, right? So in ancient Hebrew, there's no such thing as slang. Everything is slang. Everything is just the way people speak, right? Mm-hmm. And so you have things like that. You have Yehoshua turning into Yeshua. So, for example, we have a figure in Second Temple times called, he's a high priest. He's Joshua, the son of Jozadak, and he's called Yehoshua ben Yehotzadak. And then in another place in the Tanakh, he's called Yeshua ben Yotzadak. So both his name and his father's name are truncated, and that's because the hay was weakened and hence dropped. They call it syncope, if I'm not mistaken. There's these fancy Latin words for these Hebrew concepts. But whatever, they didn't know what it was called. They just knew how to speak, right?
Exactly.
And you could say they spoke wrong, but everybody spoke that way. So what made it wrong?
Yeah, and that's the thing. It's like they weren't checking their grammar books. They weren't checking their dictionaries.
Because grammar books didn't exist.
Exactly.
And dictionaries didn't exist.
Yeah.
So what most people don't realize until they study a language at a university, and you know this, you told me you studied Assyrian at Hebrew University, so you know this. So dictionaries are languages are descriptive, not prescriptive. In other words, they describe what scholars find. So it wasn't that somebody in ancient Israel was writing the book of Nehemiah, my favorite book, and said, oh, I'm looking for a word that means such and such. Let me go look in the dictionary. No, on the contrary, he wrote what he wrote. And then later we go and we look and we say, so what does this word mean in its context? And they don't always get it right.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. You know, you look in the Brown Driver Briggs dictionary and you can't assume their definition is correct. Their definition is the end process of them interpreting the verse. And here's the problem. People who don't realize that, they'll go to the Brown Driver Briggs or let's be honest, the Strong's Concordance.
Thank you.
And they'll go to the Strong's Concordance and they'll say, now that I got the meaning from the Strong's, let me go interpret the verse. And that's backwards.
Yep.
That's the tail wagging the dog. That's the opposite of the very man who created the Strong's Concordance, what he was supposed to do, I'm not sure he actually did this, but what he was supposed to do was go to the verse, figure out what the word means in all the different verses, and it might have four different meanings, and then you give the definition in your lexicon. And I say I'm not sure he did that because sometimes it sounds like he pulled the definition out of the thin air, especially in the lexicon. So that's a very important distinction. Are we talking about the name yet? I'm not sure, but I'm gonna let you lead the conversation.
We're getting there, and I definitely appreciate that because, you know, these are definitely some of the things that are on my mind, and, you know, I've tried to share some of, you know, the things that you're saying. I've shared these in my own way with people, especially about the name Yeshua. I mean, that one just drives me nuts that you have to say, you know, Yeshua or all these variations that they come up with, and I'm like, you know, that's just not right. And then, of course, the whole thing about Yahuwah, or I'm like, you know, guys.
Well, so here I want to make it very, I want to make a sharp distinction here. And so you studied at Hebrew University, so you understand this. So the reason there's a question about how to pronounce the name of the father, Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, is because Jewish tradition, going back 1800, 1850 years, had a prohibition to speak that name. And the name was preserved. It was preserved underground. And when somebody spoke up, like in the 15th century, and actually spoke it, he was condemned, publicly condemned. And that's how we know it, because we have the letter of condemnation. It's kind of cool. The name Yeshua, which is a shortened form of Joshua, of Yehoshua. And how do I know that? Because Joshua, the son of Nun, and Joshua, the son of Jozadak, two figures in the Bible, are called Yehoshua and Yeshua. So that's not even a question. So those two names, the name Yeshua, which is short for Yehoshua, isn't a matter of dispute. There's never been a question about how that name was pronounced, because it was a name people had. I'm actually doing some genealogy. It's one of my little hobbies that I'm working on recently. I've been able to trace my ancestry back to King David, which is pretty cool. But I found I had an ancestor who I always was told was, his name was Yehoshua. And I saw how, and it was, his name was Yehoshua, but it's written in the documents as Yeshua. So people always had that name. So there was never a question how to speak that name. And so when people come along and say, well, the true name of they're messianic, so they'll say of the Messiah is Yehoshua. And it's like, why do we need to make up a new name where a name has existed for thousands of years? And there happened to be a man from Nazareth. And of course, You know, you would say it wasn't happened to be, like, you know, I don't want to belittle that. My point is that his name was Yeshua, which was a very common name at the time. And if you would have asked any ancient Israelite, how do you pronounce this name? He would have said Yeshua. He would have done the little I thing.
Right? Yeah, exactly.
But it would have been Yeshua. It wasn't a question. It isn't a question today.
And just for some of the listeners, you know, again, sometimes a prophet is not appreciated in his own city. But, you know, this whole idea that the name Jesus, the English name Jesus, is an abomination, because it's actually from Jesus or any one of these stupid variations, right? You know, yeah, exactly. I pull my hair out too. And I'm like, you guys, are you serious? I mean, come on. You know, but just address that. Okay, maybe they'll listen to you.
All right, so let's back up. So the name Yehoshua became Yeshua in Second Temple times, and that was because the letter He, there were people, Jews, who didn't pronounce that letter, or they pronounced it in a very soft way, and Yehoshua became Yeshua. Okay, Yofi. Now we got that far. So then you come along to Greek times, and there are these Greek, really Greek Jews up in the Galilee, and in Greek there's no sh sound. So Yeshua became Yeshua. And in Greek, pretty much every name ends in on or us, right? Joseph becomes Josephus. So Yeshua becomes Jesus. And there are people named Jesus who have nothing to do with the man from Nazareth. And why do I say that? Meaning the man in the New Testament, Yeshua of Nazareth. There are people named Yeshua who are also called Jesus. And there's this amazing ossuary. An ossuary is a bone box. It was discovered in Israel in the 70s or 80s, and it was published by this guy named Rahmani. And I have a little book called The Naming of Jesus in Hebrew Matthew. I bring the reference there. And on the ossuary, on one side of the ossuary, it says Yeshua. What they did is so when they would bury somebody, they would let the body decay, and then they would crawl into the tomb about a year later, and they would collect the bones and put them in a box. And that was called second burial. And the box used for second burial to put the bones in is called an ossuary. And it was considered an honor specifically for a son, which is, like, we can't even imagine this today. But it was specifically considered a blessing and an honor for the son to collect the bones of his father. So we have hundreds, maybe thousands of these ossuaries. Certainly hundreds of them have names on them of who's buried in them. And one of the ossuaries has the name Yeshua on one side in Hebrew. And on the other side, it says Jesus. Now, why does it say Jesus? Which is Jesus, right? There's no J in ancient Greek. So in English, they wrote it with a J. When it was originally written as a J in English, nobody pronounced it Jesus. They pronounced it Jesus, just like in Greek. Mm-hmm. Over time, people who didn't know Greek and Latin, they forgot, and so they started pronouncing it Jesus. But Jesus was the name of some guy who died in Jerusalem, and he's buried in this ossuary that was discovered by archaeologists. And, you know, it's not Yeshua of Nazareth. I'm not saying that. On the contrary, it's just some guy. It was a very common name, and his name was Jesus. And there's actually, you know, did you hear the controversy a few years ago about the other ossuary that said Yeshua, son of Joseph? Mm-hmm. So what they didn't mention, I don't think they mentioned, to be fair, maybe they did mention, but certainly in the news media they didn't mention that there are two ossuaries from the Second Temple period that say Yeshua, the son of Joseph, because it was such a common name.
Right, yeah.
You know, I just found out there's another guy named Nehemia Gordon. He spells his name the same way I do, and that's not a common name. So right. Imagine if your name is John Smith. Well, of course there's another John Smith in Jerusalem. Right. So Yeshua Bar Yosef or Ben Yosef was like John Smith. It was such a common name.
Yeah.
You know, maybe it wasn't quite John Smith, but Yeshua was probably Simon, Yeshua, Joseph, those were among the most common names. To the point where, for example, when you read the Mishnah and you hear something Rabbi Yosef said, Rabbi Joseph, you don't know who that is. There's 10 guys named Rabbi Joseph. Mm-hmm. Right. And you have, you know, Judah was a common name. You have a bunch of different historical figures named Yeshua. So the point is that this was such a common name. There was never a question how to speak it. The name Jesus in Greek, there's no theological negativity there or connotation. It's simply the Greek form of Yehoshua. And it comes from the fact that the Greeks don't have a sh sound. They make it s. And they don't have what's called the ayin. I won't get into that complicated thing. But there's a letter in Hebrew that most English speakers can't pronounce. Mm-hmm. That's the last letter of Yeshua. And so Yeshua becomes Yeshu, which then becomes Jesus. I mean, it's just very simple. And when they first wrote that in the English Bible, they were copying it from the Greek, or sorry, from the German. And the German, to this day, when you have a J, the J is pronounced Y. Mm-hmm. So when Germans write Jehovah, they don't pronounce it Jehovah. They pronounce it Yehovah.
Right.
And when they write Jesus, they pronounce it something like Jesus. My German is kind of rusty, but something like that. But the J is pronounced as a Y in German. And so the point is Jesus has nothing to do with Zeus. Now, did you study Greek in your studies?
Yes. Yeah, I did.
So so there's a letter in the Greek alphabet called Zeta. Mm-hmm. I was taught to pronounce it Zeta as a combination of D and Z.
Yeah, me too.
I don't know where they got that. Yeah. The modern Greek pronouncers, I don't think they pronounce it that way. But anyway, so there's a letter Zeta or Zeta, and Zeus is spelled with a Zeta, and Jesus is spelled with a Sigma. Mm-hmm. So the two words have nothing to do with each other. One is an S and one is a Z, or the equivalent in English of S and Z. So it's just ridiculous to say that Jesus means Oh, hail Zeus. I mean, only in the made-up messianic language, not in a real language that has ever been known and studied and spoken by ancient people.
We don't do that at my messianic congregation, so don't worry.
Okay. Well, so maybe it's not fair to blame it on messianic, because there is a kind of a movement called the Sacred Namers, and I think they're the ones who came up with this a lot, you know. But it's not based on any solid scholarship. It's based on unsolid scholarship. It's just completely plucked out of thin air.
I don't know where they got it. It's just
they got it thing. From the fact that Jesus sounded to somebody like Zeus, but Zeus wasn't even Zeus. It was Zeus or Zevs in some dialects of Greece. And so that had nothing to do with Jesus. I mean, it's just ridiculous. Or even Jesus is probably how it was pronounced. Jesus and Zevs have nothing to do with each other. It's just ridiculous.
Yeah, I love this. You're bringing out all these great insights into the language. So you know, getting back to the word, you know, Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh or Yehovah. Yeah. I mean, I completely agree with you. I wrote a very short paper, you know, kind of based on your research. When I read your paper about, you know, I counted 39. You might have counted a little bit differently, but I counted 39 different places where you'd
in the Leningrad Codex you're talking about.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So to date, and as of today, you're hearing it for the first time, public.
Okay. Yeah.
Literally for the first time. So if we would have done this interview yesterday, I would have told you to date we found the name Yehovah with the full vowels in 5 Masoretic manuscripts. People who will say, you know, I bought a Bible at the bookstore, and in the Hebrew it has the full vowels Yehovah. Okay, I'm not so impressed by that. I want to see it in the ancient Hebrew manuscripts. Mm. And we have a class of manuscripts that begin in around the year 800 and go up to around the year 1250, and they're called Masoretic manuscripts. There's about 50 or 60 of them. And I say 50 or 60 because it depends which ones you include, right? It's always like that. But there's roughly 50 or 60. Some of them are very difficult to get a hold of. Today, or as of yesterday, we had found the name Yehovah with the full vowels in five of those Masoretic manuscripts: the Aleppo Codex, Leningrad Codex, Cairo Codex of the Prophets, Damascus Crown, and the Hebrew Union College number one manuscript. Today we found it in the sixth manuscript, literally today. And I won't even take credit. I've been communicating with somebody from your community, in fact, who wrote to me, and he had done this amazing work where he went through one of these manuscripts and found the name, like, I don't know, many, many times in the Damascus Crown. And I said, hey, would you like another project? And I sent him a link to now one of the key manuscripts of the Masoretic text, the British Library Oriental 4445, which I've been hearing about for 25-30 years and never saw until about a week ago.
Wow.
Because I mean, how are you going to get a photo? You're going to go to the British Library? And I learned about a week ago that I can find it online. It's been digitized and scanned by the British Library.
Yay.
We live in this amazing period. So I write to this gentleman and I say, would you be willing to go through, you know, I know it'll take you months, but would you be willing to go through and find places that have Yud Heh Vav Heh with the full vowels Yehovah? And it only has the Torah, by the way. So, but it's still something like 200 pages. I don't know. It was a lot.
Yeah.
2 days, or maybe two or three days. And he found two cases that definitively have the name Yehovah with the full vowels.
Wow.
So as of today, we have six manuscripts.
Wow.
And I've decided I need to look for more. You know, which in the past I didn't really occur to me, but now there's so much that's been digitized online. Mm-hmm. I would be shocked if we don't find. Now imagine that he looks through the entire Torah. I don't know off the top of my head how many times the name Yud Heh Vav Heh appears in the Torah, but it's got to be at least in the hundreds. I don't know that it's in the thousands. Maybe you could check for me. And he finds it two times in the entire Torah. Now maybe he missed one or two, right? But it can't be more than a handful of times in the whole Torah. And the point is that the scribes, number one, knew the name, and number two, were intent on hiding how to pronounce that name.
Wow.
And every once in a while they slipped up and they put in the full vowels. Most of the time they left out the full vowels. The name is actually unreadable because there's a missing vowel in the Masoretic text. And out of those X number of times in the Torah, there's two, maybe there's a few more he missed. I'm willing to admit that, you know, the guy was skimming. So let's say there's 5 or 10, right? Which I doubt there are, but he found two instances out of hundreds, maybe thousands in the Torah, which means their goal was to hide this name. And every once in a while they slipped up and let the name be known. Now what happened is over time, especially when they got to printing, then they started putting that missing O, the O is the missing vowel. Then they started putting it in all the time, especially in the Rabbinic Bible of 1524. Mm-hmm. There it appears, not everywhere, but most of the time.
Just to let you know, I found it 161 times in the Torah.
That's it?
That's
now you've challenged me. I've got to go, well, this will well, take too much.
You know, just doing a quick search here. That's the...
And how did you search it, just out of curiosity?
So that's with no vavs on it or anything like that. So that's only going to be just the name.
So in my that didn't work.
If I do another search, would it have the vav or any other thing? But it may include. Oh no!
So look, I'm using Accordance.
Okay, so that's 1555 times. So
exactly what I found in Accordance. Okay, right? 1,555.
Okay.
And this gentleman. Oh, okay. And to be fair, there were some pages in the Oriental 4445, which were from a later period, because there were missing pages, and some guy in the 1500s decided to fill them in. So I said, don't look in those pages. We don't really care what's in the 16th century. We want to see what's in this 10th century manuscript. 1555 mm-hmm. in the sections he checked. Let's say there was 1,000, right? I don't know the exact number. It'd be worthwhile to go check that number. So he only checked in the original pages, not in the pages that were supplemented in the 16th century. So we have it in six manuscripts, which is pretty cool. And what's really cool to me is we have access to these manuscripts today. We have people around the world who actually care, who are willing to spend their own time and energy and effort to try to find God's holy name. What an amazing blessing this is. Hallelujah.
Now, there are some people would say that, you know, the fact that the Jews were so meticulous about copying the text, the suggestion that they were deliberately hiding this or they missed it or whatever excuse we want to give them, it seems really far-fetched. What would you say to that?
Okay. So first of all, there's no question that the way the name normally appears in the Masoretic text is with a missing vowel. And I have not heard a satisfactory explanation of why one of the vowels is missing. The common explanation you'll find, like in, I think it's in Gazinius, in his Hebrew grammar, is that the vowels in Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh are actually the vowels of the word Shema, which is the Aramaic word for Hashem, meaning the name. But there's no evidence for that. He just made that up. He was looking for a word that fit into that slot. We don't have a Jewish source that would suggest that would corroborate that. That's number one. Number two is they were very, very, very meticulous. But if we're saying there's 1,000 instances of the name in this Oriental 4445 manuscript in the British Library, and only two of them have the full vowels, that's pretty meticulous. If you look at human DNA, it has genetic mutations at a higher, and I'm talking about the DNA in my body and your body, right? Because most mutations aren't going to cause a problem. There's mutations in any person's DNA, meaning it replicates with more mutations than what these scribes, with what they produced in copying the name. So that's actually really impressive, the level of accuracy. Having said that, I can show you, for example, I was looking at this today, there's one passage in the Leningrad Codex where it says Adonai, and in the very same verse, it's in Psalm 60-something, in the very same verse in the Aleppo Codex, it says, or I'm sorry, I got that backwards. In one of them it says Adonai, and the other it says Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh. That's a huge difference. That's not a small difference. So it's in the Leningrad, it says Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh. And in the Aleppo, it says Adonai. And that's why I say there's 6,827 in the Aleppo and 6,828. So if I search right now in accordance in the entire Tanakh, I'm going to find 6,828. And that's because accordance is based on the Leningrad. And there I got 6,828. But if I were to actually go and look at that specific passage in Psalms, I could pull it up if you really want to know where it is. So if I look at that specific passage in the Aleppo, which I did, I looked it up, and I even posted the photo of – I posted a photo side by side of the exact passage, you know, with the Aleppo and the Leningrad on my Facebook page a few years back. And I was just looking through my files today, and I came across that image. So imagine that. The difference between the word Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh and Adonai is a huge difference. We're not talking about vowels. We're talking about four consonants different, right? It can happen. Yeah. Right? And especially when there's a word that's being copied over and over and over and over. And here's a really important point. We have six manuscripts that usually the name is missing a vowel, except every once in a while it has the full vowels. And those full vowels are Yehovah. Mm-hmm. Those full vowels are never Yahweh.
That's true.
Those full vowels are never Yehuah.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
And look, my friend Keith Johnson, he pointed out that there's places where it has the vowels Yehovi because the scribe was indicating to pronounce the name there as Elohim. And he said there's more evidence in the Hebrew language for the pronouncing the name Yehovi than there is for Yahweh. And he's right. Now, one of the pieces of evidence I don't think I've ever publicly brought before, so this is breaking news. Or maybe I won't bring it. We only have 7 minutes left. But so recently I've been working on research where I found the name Yud-Heh-Vav, I found the name in six Masoretic manuscripts as of this morning, or it has been found. I didn't find it in one of them. Somebody else found it. it's been found in six Masoretic manuscripts with the full vowels Yehovah. A few months back, I started doing some actually, even before that, 5 years ago, someone sent me an email and said, you know, you wrote this book, Shattering Conspiracy of Silence, saying that the name is Yehovah. Did you know that's what the rabbis say too? I said, well, I didn't know that. What do you mean? The rabbis don't know how to pronounce it. Everybody knows that. And if they do know how to pronounce it, it's a secret. And it turns out it is a secret. But every once in a while, in the tens or hundreds of thousands of pages in rabbinical literature, the secret slips out. And I found 11 rabbis to date who say that the vowels of the name are Yehovah.
Wow.
So that we've got six Masoretic. And for I'll be honest with you, the six Masoretic, one Masoretic manuscript has more weight for me than a million rabbis. Don't misunderstand me. That for me is the key information. However, here we have evidence from the rabbis of how to pronounce the name, and no rabbi I've been able to find pronounces it Yahweh. Now, I have found rabbis who have proposed other pronunciations. Specifically, there's a rabbi in the 12th century named Rashbam, who said that the true pronunciation is Yehiveh. It's based on the analogy of Yehiyeh. And there's another rabbi who says it's something like Yehovah Hey or some really silly thing like that. But there's a rabbi who says that. Mm-hmm. So you have these minority opinions of these individual rabbis. I found three alternative opinions, and in each case, I only found one rabbi who said that alternative opinion. But I found 11 rabbis who say it's Yehovah. And when they say it's Yehovah, they're not proclaiming it from the rooftops. They mm-hmm. are hiding it. They're doing everything they can to hide it. I have one letter that I found. I'm working on a study. I'm trying to compile all this. I actually, when I got to 11, I said, okay, I need to back up. I'm going to call this 10 rabbis speak out on the name, because that sounds better than 11, right? Because 10 in Jewish tradition is a minyan. It's a prayer quorum. So we have 10 rabbis, actually 11, 10 rabbis who say the name is Yehovah. And one of them, it turns out, remember I told you I was doing this genealogy thing?
Yeah.
So I got to tell you, I've been doing this research. Sometimes I won't be able to get to bed till 5 in the morning, because I'll be like at 3 in the morning, I'll be shaking. I'm so excited with some of the things I'm finding. I'm not kidding. It's just so exciting, some of these sources I'm finding, these rabbinical sources. And at one point a few weeks ago, I decided to put down those sources because my head was spinning. I literally couldn't see straight at one point because I was staring at the screen, 18 hours a day reading these sources. And I decided I'm gonna go work on my little genealogy project. And while I'm working on the genealogy project, I find out I'm descended from this rabbi who's one of the 11 rabbis who says the name is Yehovah.
And
I'm like, wow, this is amazing. And that rabbi specifically, he says in his letter, he said, you need to hide this letter. He said, it's very difficult to put these things in writing. So when you get this letter, hide it in a pure and holy place.
Wow.
And I realized, wow, I've talked in the past about the sins of my ancestors and hiding God's holy name. But I meant ancestors in the very, vague sense, right? The Jewish people.
Right.
But now I find out that literally my ancestors, who I can trace back the names in each generation to get back to that ancestor. I mean, it's not just, I know I'm descended from the Maharam of Lublin. I can show you now, after doing all this research, how I'm directly descended from that rabbi. And he personally was involved in hiding the name. And so I really feel I need to atone for the sins of my ancestors for hiding the name.
That is powerful. That is very powerful.
It really is. I mean, it blew me away. I'm trying to work on my little genealogy project, and it sucked me back in.
That's almost something that kind of just bring you one of these tears moments, where you're like, oh my goodness, Lord, this is amazing.
I'll tell you, the last few months while I was doing this research, I've been shaking. I've been in tears. I've been where I couldn't go to sleep. I mean, there was this one situation where I found out about a book written in the 13th century. And I was so excited about this. I couldn't sleep. So I called up a friend in Israel and I begged this friend. I said, would you please go to a bookstore, buy the book and overnight it to me? And overnight in Israel usually takes 3 days. So I said, I'm not going to sleep for 3 days until that. And I didn't, I barely slept for 3 days. And it didn't disappoint. It turns out it's a book called The Book of the Divine Name. And it was a book written in 1225. It wasn't published until 2004 because it was being kept secret, meaning it was only copied by hand for nearly 800 years. And it has some really exciting stuff in it that looks like we don't have time to get into. But I am working on this study that tentatively is called 10 Rabbis Speak Out on the Name or on the Tetragram. I don't know what I'm going to call it. But it's really exciting stuff.
So just if you have a few more minutes Sure. There's a lot of questions. In the chat room here, I'd like to maybe just get to a couple of them.
Okay, we have a chat room. Where's that?
We do. It's actually on the live stream.
Okay. I don't get to see it.
The link that I sent you, if you wanna.
No, you'll read it to me. Tell me what the
questions
are.
Yeah.
We'll do a few. I mean, because this is supposed to be an hour show, right?
Yeah. No one's gonna get mad at us if we go too long, but we won't.
Let's give it a crack.
Right. So, so first of all, many people say thank you for coming on. They appreciate that. Yeah. And one person is saying the Yehovah Brigade have made big assumptions. That's for sure.
What now? Oh, the Yehovah people make big. So what the Yehovah people do, and this is how it was explained to me, they take the name Judah, which is Yehovah Odeh, which becomes Yehuda by dissimulation, and they say, let's take out the Dalet, and it becomes Yehuah. why would you do that? I mean, by what principle of the Hebrew language would you do that? I don't know. Yeah.
Okay. So this is from a man here. I just saw it. Sorry. One guy is saying that it's Yehuda. You know, it's pretty clear. And
yeah, Yehuda is like Yeshua. There's no dispute about it. Okay. I've got an ancestor named Yehuda. I've got an ancestor named Yeshua. These are names people had as part of a living linguistic tradition that they never disappeared.
Right. So the question then is Yehuda, is that proof that it should be Yahuwah? That's one of the questions there.
So I wish I could come up with an example in English of where you take out a letter. I can't think of an example in Hebrew, that's for sure. Like, I don't even know what the example is. I mean, you take out a letter and then you get the remaining vowels. I mean, by what principle would that? First of all, Yahuwah has an aleph in it.
Mm-hmm.
Hebrew. Yahuwah clearly has an aleph that's pronounced in it.
Yeah.
Unless they want to say it's a furtive patach, like Mashiach, but then Yehuda doesn't have a patach, it has a kamatz. And I hope we're not confusing people, but it's two completely different vowels.
Right.
It doesn't even make sense. It's not just taking out the dalet, it's taking out the dalet, shifting one of the vowels over to the left and changing that vowel. I mean, it's a lot going on there.
Yeah.
What justification is there for doing that?
He says that his statement is absolutely true, that the father's name is spelled exactly like Judah without the Dalit. You guys are drawing conclusions about that fact, not me, is what he says. So that's from Adrian.
Absolutely. We're drawing conclusions based on the consistent rules of the Hebrew language as it was spoken and written for thousands of years. And what he's saying has nothing to do with the Hebrew language. It's a rule he just made up that you can take out. And help me out here with a rule in English. I wish I had an example in English where you take out a letter and then you end. It just doesn't work that way in Hebrew. I don't know about English. I'll give you an example. The word Israel, Yisrael. And if I want to say he will ask in Hebrew, how do I say he will ask? I say Yish'al. Now, if I take out the resh of Yisrael, I get then Yisrael, and so he asks should be Yisrael and not Yish'al. And that's 100% true. The word he asked is spelled the exact same way as Israel without the resh. But it's not pronounced that way. that doesn't even make sense. I don't know. Right. Is that too complicated an example? I mean,
No. And I think what happens is that people get very attached emotionally and theologically to these ideas. And, you know, something I've tried to tell my students is that, you know, guys, if our theology disagrees with the Bible, then we should throw out our theology. And, you know, we're just talking grammar here. We're just talking grammar. We're talking just academics. All right. So, and this is, you know, whatever his name is, it's fine, you know. But the evidence points us to Yehovah. That's where the evidence is. That's where the rules of the Hebrew grammar, the dikduk, right? The grammar shows us that this is what it is. And you know, Yahweh or Yahweh, however you want to say, that is not reflected in Hebrew, okay? Yahuwah is not reflected in Hebrew.
At least Yahweh is potentially a Hebrew word. Yahuwah isn't even potentially a Hebrew word.
Exactly. Right. Now, do you happen to think that it's based on Hayah, Hove, Yihyeh?
Oh, absolutely. There's not even a question about that. Yeah. That's the really cool thing. I was recently doing an interview with a Samaritan. In fact, it's a guy named Binyamin Sadaka. It's, you know, I do this podcast called Hebrew Voices, and I have such a backlog of episodes I need to edit. Maybe I should just do this thing where I get somebody on and we talk live. I don't know. But we talk for like 6 hours, and I've got to edit that down to like an hour, probably a series of hour podcasts. So I interviewed him like maybe a year ago, and he's the top Samaritan scholar. He's written 107 books.
Wow.
If I wrote that many books, I don't even know that I'd be able to keep track of that many. I mean, how does he even know he wrote 107 books? Anyway, so he wrote 107 books. He's the top Samaritan scholar. And in the interview, he tells me that, I say, so how do you guys pronounce the name of God? Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh. He says, we don't pronounce the name today. And we've never pronounced the name. And I say, okay, you never pronounced the name. What about in the time of Aaron and Moses? He said, in the time of Aaron and Moses, we did not pronounce the name. He said, today we call God Shema, which is the Aramaic word for the name. And in ancient times, we called them Asham, which is the Samaritan Hebrew pronunciation of Hashem. They have a slightly different dialect of Hebrew, mm-hmm. which is, I mean, we could go to a whole rabbit trail there. 2 Kings right. 17, the Samaritans coming in. Anyway, worshiping a guy named Ashima. Anyway, but he said, while we don't pronounce the name, I can tell you what it means. And what does it mean, Binyamin Tzedakah says to me? He says, it's Hayahoveh Hiyeh. He that was, he that is, and he that is to come, or he will be. So you have Samaritans saying that. You have Jews saying that. You even have that in the New Testament. In the book of Revelation, you have 3 or 4 passages where it refers to the one who was, the one who is, and who is to come. And sometimes it changes the order, but that doesn't matter. So you have 3 different sources unanimously agreeing that the name has the meaning of he that was, he that is, and he that is to come. And what does that mean in Hebrew? It means he has always existed, he exists now, and he always will exist. And that's why that's combined in the New Testament with Alpha and Omega, first and last, meaning he's not a God who has come into being at some point and then will cease to exist. He's always he's eternal. I mean, it's basically the Hebrew way of saying eternal. Now, this actually creates a problem for the name Yahweh, because Yahweh is based on the Hebrew verb Hayah, and it's either the PL or the Hefil form, depending who you ask. Mm-hmm. And it would mean then in the Hefil, he that causes to be. Okay, but that verb never actually exists in the history of the Hebrew language in that form. Right. You could create a new form. I mean, okay. Or I should say, I don't know what form existed that wasn't written down. Meaning, if 2 Israelites were having a conversation in ancient times and they wanted to say he will cause to exist, maybe they would have said Yahweh. But if they ever had that conversation, it was never recorded. We have no evidence that anybody ever used the verb Hayah to be in the Hefil form. And scholars admit this is a hypothetical form. And the reason that especially the German school was attracted to this specific form is that it fit their theology, that the name of God should mean he that causes to be. He's the creator God, right? Genesis chapter 1 begins with creation. Although in Genesis chapter 1, he's not called Yehovah. He's called Elohim, but whatever. That would have been a good time to explain that. And when he does explain his name, he says, Ehyeh Asher Ehyeh, which means I will be that which I will be. That's, you know, the translation of Ehyeh Asher Ehyeh, meaning he's explaining the meaning of his name as derived from the root Hayah, to be. Uh-huh. And that's actually the standard explanation. That's something, I'm not clever. I didn't come up with something new. You know, this isn't like I have to write an academic paper, so I've got to come up with a new idea. No, basically, most Jewish scholars who have dealt with this in the past, going back, you know, I don't know, over 1,000 years, maybe 2,000 years, have agreed that Ehyeh Asher Ehyeh is the explanation of the name Yud-Heh Vav-Heh. And the Yud-Heh Vav-Heh means Hayahoveh Yeh, he was, he is, he is to come, he will be. So
awesome. I think that's fantastic. We've got a number of other questions here. I'm not really sure that some
give
of them
me some
are...
hard ones. I'm not promising to answer. Give me a hard one.
Well, okay, all right. This is not so much a academic question. I mean, some people are concerned that you don't believe in Jesus, and so maybe we shouldn't be talking. Just let me just say before you say anything. You know, we don't always agree with everybody that we speak to, okay? And I consider Nehemia a great scholar. I think he loves the Lord.
Wait, in 21st century America, if you find someone to punch them in the face and not talk to them, that seems to be the new policy that's being instituted after 8 years. Mm. So anyway, I'm sorry I interrupted you on this radio.
Well, you know, I think you probably know more about the New Testament than many Christians that I've bumped into. And I want to glean what I can from you. I think that's awesome. And insofar as Jesus is part of this, he'll speak to you when the time is necessary. But, you know, I think this idea that the only conversation that we can have with a non-Christian is about, hey, you got to believe in the name of Jesus. I think that is really missing the point here. I think, you know, especially for a show like this, we're talking about a specific topic, and we should, you know, stay on that topic. And I know that Nehemia has been around. He's been around a lot of Christians, so I'm sure he's gotten the gospel on many different occasions. And so
I don't know, more times than you have.
Yeah, exactly. You know, so go ahead. I mean, whatever you want.
Yeah. So Well, so yeah, and I don't think it's a hard topic. I think it's an important topic to bring up. I don't want to sweep that under the rug. Let's go back to Yehua. Let me share a story. I got this email a few years back from a guy who writes to me, and he says, "How dare you say the name is Yehovah? God personally told me in a vision that his name is Yahuwashi." And I'm a little bit embarrassed because I wrote back to him and I said, "That's actually really funny. I thought he was joking," and he was not joking. He was dead serious. So I shouldn't have, you know, mocked him. I mean, I thought he was joking. He wasn't. And this is an important point. If God has told you personally his name is Yehovah Hey or Yuhuvuhu, then who am I to say that's not his name? I'm telling you, based on the evidence, based on the information that we have, based on solid logic, language, and reasoning, what I believe the name is. I don't have a recording from God speaking to Moses at the burning bush. So all I have is the evidence. If you have God speaking to you directly, telling you the name of something else, well, don't listen to me. You should go call him that name. Once you've discerned if that's truly God speaking. So that's completely valid. I mean, from a theological perspective, you believe that, and look, I'll encounter people who will say, Nehemia, Yeshua never spoke the name, and we know he never spoke the name because the New Testament was written in Greek, and every letter we have the Holy Spirit, and therefore when it says in the Greek that Yeshua said Lord, that's not a translation from the Hebrew Yehovah, and therefore they don't want to speak the name. I don't have a problem with that. I mean, that's not my theology, but if you believe that every letter of the Greek New Testament is exactly what was revealed by the Holy Spirit, or I don't know the exact doctrine, and it probably varies, but was revealed by God, let's put it in those terms, mm-hmm. In that original language that we have today, or it was preserved by God, so that every single letter is perfect, and therefore, say Adonai, he said Kurios in Greek, he said Lord. Okay, who am I to argue with that? Right? Sure. I mean, that's a theological position. And I have theological positions. I believe there's a creator of the universe. And I believe he's one. And I believe he chose the people of Israel. I'll admit those are theological positions that I think happen to correspond to history. But these are my theological positions. And I think it's important to be aware of what are my theological positions that I bring with me to the table. And what are the positions that I'm actually deriving from the text? And those are, and sometimes, usually it's a combination, and it might be 80-20, but I think it's important to be aware of that. I think that's extremely important. And I'm very upfront with people. I'm not a Christian. I'm not a messianic. I've had people literally pray over me many, many times that God would reveal his son to me. And I've prayed for God to reveal his son to me. And I continue to pray that. I want to know the truth. I want to know who God has chosen as his son to be the Messiah over the world, Messiah over Israel that will bring peace to the world. May that be soon. Amen.
Amen.
Can I get an amen?
I agree with that.
Can we get an amen in the chat room?
Amen. Amen. All right. Here's a question from Arthur. He says, I know you were not there, but how was the language pronounced before the 10th century Masoretes invented the vowel markings, the Nikudim?
Ooh, I like he said vowel markings and not the vowels, because that's a very common misunderstanding that the Masoretes invented the vowels, which is ridiculous. Every language every spoken language by definition has vowels and consonants, verbs, adjectives, various other things. The only language that don't have vowels are like sign language. As far as I know, it doesn't have vowels, or it doesn't have to have vowels. But every spoken language has to have vowels. So the question is, when were the vowels written down? That is actually, there's a whole library written debating when the vowels were written down. I'm not going to hash out that debate here. Let's say for argument's sake that the vowels were written sometime, and it wasn't in the 10th century by the Masoretes. They were created slight, I think the more accepted scholarly opinion is sometime around the year 600 is when you have the Masoretes. Mm-hmm. Between 600 and maybe 800-900 is when, according to mainstream scholarship, which I can debate, but it's not worth doing that for this purpose. The vowels were transcribed or they had a reading tradition, and that reading tradition was written down sometime between 600 and 900 or so. So how were the vowels pronounced before that? The same way they were pronounced after it. Because what they wrote down was a reading tradition. It was fixed at a very early time in history. What do I mean by a very early time in history? I can prove to you that the vowels were fixed by around the year 90. And how do I know that? I actually bring some of this in my book, Shattering the Conspiracy of Silence. By the way, I have a 18-hour DVD series or YouTube series now that you can watch online for free called the Open Door Series. It's 9 hours of me teaching, 9 hours of Keith Johnson. A lot of it is on the name, but on other things too. And I'm pretty sure I share this there, I think. I don't know. It's 9 hours, right? Guys, go check the Open Door Series and my podcast, Hebrew Voices, and my website, nehemiahswall.com or nehemiahswall.com. But what were we talking about?
Well, we were answering a question there. Another one, somebody just wanted some clarification.
No, let me answer that. Oh, so I can prove to you that by around the year 90, the vowels were written down. And there's this great story about the rabbis interpreting a certain passage. And they interpret the passage contrary to the vowels. And it shows you that and they say, don't read it this way, read it this other way. It shows you that the reading was fixed by around the year 90. Now, whether it was written down or not, that's a matter of debate. But that the vowels were fixed by a reading tradition that even the rabbis didn't have the authority and the ability to change, I think is a fact. And what's interesting is that for the purposes of interpretation, they read it with the altered vowels. But go to any synagogue in the world today, and they read it with the original vowels. And this is actually very embarrassing to the rabbis that in every synagogue in the world, they read the verse and the vowels don't match the way the verse is interpreted. And this is in Leviticus 23. That's in my book, Shattering the Conspiracy of Silence.
You're talking about the Cray and the Kativ? Is that what you're talking about? Or what is it?
No,
that
I'm talking about a method of interpretation called Alti Cray, okay, which translates as read it not. And what they do is they'll take a word. And in this specific example, it says, Ela Moade Yehovah Shir Tikru Otam B'Moadam. These are the appointed times of Yehovah, which you will proclaim them in their appointed times. And they say, don't read it them, atem. Read it, don't read it otam, them. Read it atem, you. And what it ends up doing is changing the meaning from these are the appointed times of the Lord or Yehovah, which you will proclaim in their appointed times. It changes it to these are the appointed times of the Lord, which you yourselves shall proclaim. The crux of the entire rabbinic calendar.
Wow.
Now go to any synagogue in the world, go to any printed Bible, and the original vowels are still there. So they didn't even have the authority to change the vowels. If they could have changed the vowels, they would have. And then nobody could have questioned it. In fact, the Karaite Jews questioned it. And they said, wait a minute, that's not what it says in the Bible. And it's interesting because this is a story told in the Mishnah, and it becomes the most quoted Mishnaic passage in Karaite Jewish literature. In fact, it's even quoted in my book because it's an example where the rabbis are interpreting the verse openly. They're admitting, they're saying, look, this isn't what it says. But for purpose of interpretation, we needed to say something else. Yet it still says in that specific example of Alti Cray, it's an issue of the vowels. So the vowels were fixed by the year 90, possibly before then.
Wow. I did not know that. I mean, that was really was quite a lesson. I did not know that.
And they may not have been written down, but they were clearly fixed in some form. And there's other examples I bring in my book, which are a little bit more technical.
Wow. That's just fantastic. It's really great.
Incidentally, for the purposes of the name, it's irrelevant. Even if the vowels were not written down, people knew how to speak God's name. My book, Shattering the Conspiracy of Silence, the reason I called it that is there's a passage in the Babylonian Talmud, Kedushin 71a, which says roughly, rabbis transmit the name to their disciples once every 7 years, and some say twice every 7 years. So there was a debate of how to do it. And so they knew what the name was. They agreed it had to be kept secret. But they didn't want the secret to be forgotten, so they would whisper it to their disciples every 7 years. Mm. So whether the name was written down or not with vowels isn't even that important. When the vowels finally were written down, at least for this purpose, it's not that important. When the vowels finally were written down, it was with the vowels that they knew the name to be pronounced. And again, they usually left out one of the vowels because they didn't want people like me pronouncing the name.
So this started because of the Romans not wanting them. So this is after the Bar Kokhba revolt.
Yeah.
that they...
Well, it's one of the things that triggered the Bar Kokhba revolt, actually.
That saying the name or not saying the name?
The not injunction. Saying the name. So, meaning the Roman injunction is one of the things that triggered the Bar Kokhba revolt. There was an internal reason as well, and that internal reason is actually what the Mishnah explains, although you have to read the context, and most people don't. So the internal reason is that people were using the name to heal, and the rabbis perceived that as magic. And according to Deuteronomy 18, magic is forbidden. And so the original injunction in the Mishnah is formulated. It says, Abba Saul says, also he who proclaims the name according to its letters. Well, what does also mean? The context, they had just been talking about reciting verses over the sick. And specifically the verse, I am Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, your healer. And what people were doing is they were saying, Ani Adonai Rof-Echa, I am the Lord, your healer. And then some people were saying, Ani Yehovah Rof-Echa, I am Yehovah, your healer. And so that's what Abba Saul is coming to forbid. And this isn't my discovery. This is, you know, like, for example, Urbach wrote the famous book, The Sages, which I'm sure you encountered at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. It's this massive, fat book, two volumes. The second volume is just the footnotes. and he explains this in one of his like three-page footnotes, that if you look in the context and the other sources, this is a prohibition not to speak the name in the year 150 under Abba Shaul. The prohibition was to as part of a healing ritual. That was the original prohibition from the rabbinical perspective. The Romans had their own things, which they then imposed on the Jews. But from the rabbinical perspective, the issue was speaking in what they call the magical incantation. And this is very interesting because you have the name written in magical texts. I mentioned that a little bit at the beginning. And some of them are pagan magical texts. So you had some pagan in Egypt who heard the Jews using the name to heal, and he said, oh, that's a good name, I should use that. And he wrote it down, but he's writing it in Greek. So they wrote it in something like 60 different ways in Greek.
Okay. So it wasn't necessarily Jews who were using the name to heal, but
definitely Jews. It was definitely Jews who believed in Yeshua. By extension, it was then non-Jews who had heard those two groups using it.
And they were using the name Yehovah, saying, right. Yehonah, or Ani Yehovah Rofe, I'm the Lord your healer, I am Yehovah your healer.
Which is a verse in Exodus, I am Yehovah your healer.
Yeah, that's really amazing. So here they're using the name as God said, I am your healer, so, you know, do these things in my name.
You could imagine that there was somebody who was sick and they didn't have medicine, and he was lying there in bed, and a healer would come and would pray for him and with him and say, you know, I don't know what he would say, may Yehovah heal you as it is written, I am Yehovah, your healer. And the rabbis considered that to be a magical incantation, therefore forbidden, and as a result, they therefore forbade speaking the name.
Wow.
And what's interesting is they never forbade the name, and this is in the Talmud, they never forbade the name for teaching. And specifically, they talk about, look, you have to speak the name when you teach your disciples how not to do magic. That's the interesting context there. They say when you're teaching them about the laws of magic, in that context, you'll speak the name and say, look, this is how the name is pronounced. You must not say, Ani Yehovah Rofecha, which is pretty cool. So the prohibition was never 100%. It only applied to people like me and you, not to the elite rabbis.
I see.
Really?
Yeah. And what do you think? I mean, the fact that this is now being uncovered, that the name is resurging, even in some of its kind of weirder forms. But what do you think is the significance of it? Is there a theological or, you know?
Oh, absolutely.
Sort of end times so, kind of significance, you know?
So to me, this is a fulfillment of a, or the end, the ending of a curse. It's the breaking of, we have a curse in the Tanakh, a curse of exile. Give me a second here to look this up. It's in Jeremiah 44. We never found the John 10 verse. I'm disturbed by that. I'm going to find it and send it to you, and it's probably not John 10.
There you go.
Somewhere else. Or maybe somebody who was watching this video in years to come can post it in the comments. That would be nice. But he talks there about teaching his disciples his father's name or something like that. Anyway, it's in Jeremiah 44. And so the story of Jeremiah, a lot of people don't realize this. So Jeremiah is this prophet in Israel. And the Babylonians conquered Judea, and they leave behind. They actually conquered Judea in two or possibly three waves. The second or the first wave, depending how you count them, is in 597. The final wave is in 586. There may have been an earlier wave, according to some under Jehoiakim. Anyway, and by the time they're done in 586, they're only leaving the peasants and some of the lower aristocracy. So the Jews decide they're going to kill this man named Gedaliah, who is a cousin of the last king, or from the line of the king. That's what I mean by the, you know, he's like some distant cousin of the king, right? So the Babylonians leave him as a governor, and he's assassinated. And then the Jews realize we're in a lot of trouble. The Babylonians are going to come and slaughter us all because we killed their, it's bad enough our kings revolted. Now, they go down to Egypt and they take Jeremiah with them as a captive.
Mm-hmm.
And so a curse is placed upon the Jews of Egypt. And it's in Jeremiah 44:26. I'm going to read to you in the King James Version. Therefore, hear the word of the Lord. And Lord, there is, you know, Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh. All Judah who dwell in the land of Egypt, behold, I have sworn by my great name, says the Lord, or says Jehovah, that my name shall no more be named in the mouth of any man of Judah in all the land of Egypt, saying, the Lord God lives. And in Hebrew it says, Chai Adonai Yehovah, as the Lord Yehovah lives. So there was a curse placed upon the Jews who went into exile, and the curse was that they would not be able to speak God's holy name. And that curse came to pass. Now the curse originally is just about Egypt, but apparently it spread throughout the entire Jewish world, the entire diaspora world of all 12 tribes, that they were cursed and that they were not able to speak God's name. And I believe what's happening now in our times is that God is breaking this curse, that he wants his name to be spoken as he's gathering his people in. And there's no longer any Jews. There might be three Jews left in Egypt, if even that. As he's gathering his people in from Egypt, gathering his people in from the exiles, it is now. And now doesn't just mean 2017. It's a process that's been going on really for decades, since the last century and possibly even since the 19th century. It's a gradual process of the restoration of the Hebrew language, a return to speaking Hebrew, not just as a literary language, but as a daily living spoken language. And that has brought about a resurgence of knowledge and information about his holy name. If I wanted to find his name in the Aleppo Codex just 100 years ago, let me go to the Aleppo Codex and see, is his name ever written with the full vowels? That opportunity didn't exist. Now I can go to archive.org and download the entire Aleppo Codex and have it on my laptop and search page after page and see, okay, what does it really say? Are these really the vowels of Adonai? Well, quite clearly they're not the vowels of Adonai. So what is going on here? So imagine that. We live in this age where I can send an email to somebody who doesn't even think like me, who has a different faith, who thinks more like you, and who's coming from a New Testament perspective, and say, hey, here's a link to one of the most important manuscripts in the world in the British Library. Can you go and look and find if it has Yehovah with the full vowels? And he's able to do it on his computer sitting from, I don't even know where he lives. I mean, I have no idea, like even what country or what, I've never spoken to him, I've only exchanged emails. But he sent me the photos and the, you know, and the references, and I'm like, this is amazing.
You know,
so we live in a time which has such blessing where we can hash out some of these issues and get to the answers, and we don't have to live in ignorance. You know, 100 years ago, all I could do was pray to know God's name, and unless I was really lucky to be in on a secret, best I could do was say Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, the mm-hmm. best I could do. Mm-hmm. Maybe the best I could do was say Yahweh or Yahweh in Hebrew.
That is so powerful that this curse is ending. I think that's huge. You know,
really,
and I think that there's a curse ending in many, many ways, you know, but this one is just another incredible piece.
Well, it's part of the curse of exile. It's part of the process of exile ending.
Yeah.
Is that we'll no longer be barred from speaking his name, even if we want to speak his name.
That's amazing. Yeah. By the way, Fabio Hurt, he helped us out here. He says it's John 5:43.
Okay, can we open that up now?
And it says, I am come in my Father's name, and you receive me not. If any other should come in his own name, you will receive him. Is that the one?
No, that's not it. It probably is John 5, not John 10. I don't know.
We're trying. I mean, I searched, and I didn't find it in John 10 otherwise.
All right.
Just like
and maybe I dreamt that verse. Maybe it doesn't really exist. But I'm
Oh man, that's amazing.
Anyway,
That's amazing. Oh man, this is so exciting. I mean, this is really, really exciting to hear that the curse has been lifted, or that it's lifting, shall we say. It's just
Well,
it's
and
amazing.
then there's the promise to the nations, Jeremiah 12, 16. He says, it shall come to pass if they, I'm paraphrasing from memory, it shall come to pass if they learn to the way of my people to swear in my name, the way they taught my people to swear by Baal, then it shall be built in the midst of my people. It's a promise to the nations. If you learn to swear the name Yehovah rather than the name of your deities, then the name of Baal and the name of Lord, then you'll be built in the midst of his people. This is a promise to the nations. And Isaiah 56, of course, has the blessing to the nations of joining themselves to Jehovah, who love his name. I mean, so I do see this in prophetic terms. And I'll admit that's a theological way of looking at it. If I share that at Hebrew University, I'll get funny looks, right? Because like that's not the academic side of the equation. But to me, it's an important side. And if you want to disregard that because you have a different theology, I have no problem with that. That's got nothing to do with me.
Well, I mean, the point here is that academically we search these things out to just discover what is the truth, okay?
Right.
And
Absolutely.
as an academician, you try not to be emotionally invested in whatever the outcome is,
Absolutely.
because
That's
you're
absolutely
just
correct.
trying to discover what is. That's all you're trying to do. What is the evidence? Where does it lead me? And whatever it is what it is. Okay.
Right.
And then you let that become your foundation. Truth. Truth
Right.
is always what we want our foundation to be. And whatever truth is what truth is. We can't change that. Right.
Right.
So, and that's the exciting thing about it. But rather, we often, so often start with our theology and we try to
Right.
make
Right.
that the
Well,
truth.
so my friend Keith Johnson, who I wrote a book together, A Prayer to Our Father on the Hebrew Origins of the Lord's Prayer, he likes to say there's information and there's inspiration. And when you combine those two, you get revelation. And I really like that idea. That's pretty cool. And so I don't want to disregard the inspiration. If somebody had a dream in which God appeared to them, they believe, and said to them that, his name is YHWH, I mean, then they should not listen to anything. It doesn't matter what the rules of the Hebrew grammar are. It really doesn't. It doesn't matter what 11 rabbis preserved throughout history. It doesn't matter because God told you directly it was YHWH. Was that really God? I don't think so. But that's not for me to say about somebody else's dream.
Sure, I get that. I get that.
I didn't
Well,
have that dream, let me put it that way.
I could probably keep you here all evening, but I just want to thank you for coming on. We've gone half an hour over, and I really
Oh,
appreciate it.
wow.
And I think it was awesome to get into some of these questions as well. There are more, but some people we're not going to please, no matter what we say about Yehuda, et cetera. But I think you guys, I think what Nehemiah did for us, or Nehemia did for us, is that he helped us to understand what the text actually says. He brought out some incredible resources, what we call corroborating resources or corroborating sources. Okay, and as he clearly said, the Tanakh, right, the Hebrew Bible or the Old Testament, is what he goes by. That is second to none, right? But then it's good to have these other sources which
Absolutely.
corroborate that evidence, that help us to understand. And that's always a good idea, okay? And in fact, I was debating a guy on the topic of the Nephilim, and I don't know where you stand on that, but anyway, I brought in some extra biblical sources to say, look, this is what people have always thought. Okay, and he said, oh, you're using Gnostic sources. And I'm like, wait a second, I don't believe that these sources are in any way equal to the Bible. The Bible is everything to me. But so that you know that I'm not just being crazy, I'm not making things up, I'm going to show you some historical sources. And that's what Nehemiah has done for us here, is he's brought in a bunch of extra biblical historical sources. No matter what you think of the rabbis, no matter what you think of the Talmud, you have 11 or 10, but 11, 10
10
plus
sounds
one.
better.
Well, 10 plus one is very biblical, right?
There you go.
10, yay, 11, right? Then you have some very powerful witnesses that are saying, no, this is how we have been pronouncing it. This is the tradition that's come down from our fathers of how this name has actually been pronounced. And you have it in six manuscripts, right? So this is very powerful evidence that the name is Yehovah. Now, again, if you want to say Lord, if you want to say Jehovah, if you want to say Yahuwah, I mean, all right, that's fine. We're not going to get into the name police and say you got to say it the right way. But if you're at all interested in what Hebrew grammar actually dictates and what the evidence is and what the sources and the corroborating sources actually show us, then the name is Yehovah. And I think it's so powerful because, as you've clearly pointed out, Nehemia, the curse is being lifted. Maybe it's already done, but at least we're in that process of this name curse being lifted.
Yeah.
And people are beginning to discover it. And I so completely agree with you. I'm like, look, God's name is powerful, right? There's power in the name. You will run to, you know, God's name is a strong tower. I'm like, how can Lord be a strong tower? Okay, God knows who you're talking about, but my goodness, his name must be powerful,
yeah,
right? So yeah, the name of the Lord, the name Yehovah, is a strong tower. The righteous run to it and they are saved. That's what we want to do. And so there's something special about it, something exciting about it, and something just, you know, supernatural. And so I just want to thank everybody. I want to thank you, Nehemia, for joining us. Thank you, everybody in the chat room, for all of your good questions. And again, stay in the Word. The Word, the Bible, has the answers. Thankfully, God is way smarter than any of us. And
Amen.
He's going to keep showing all of us everything that we need to know, okay? And he's going to show us Christians what we need to know, and he's going to show the Jews what they need to know, and he'll work it all out. So thankfully, he's awesome, and we're just along for the ride. So again, everyone, God bless, and have a good evening.